Welcome, folks, to the Hour of the Time, the only hour that ever was or ever will be. This is the most important hour in your entire life, for during this hour, you will decide your future and thus our collective futures. I am your host, William Cooper. From the headquarters of the Citizens Agency for Joint Intelligence, former banker and financial analyst Michael William Haga, author of the forthcoming book, On the Brink, How to Survive the Coming Great Depression, 1993 to 2000, says, within the next 12 months, the international banking system will collapse. The world's stock exchanges will crash to pre-World War II levels. Real estate values will plunge 85% or more, and countless numbers of ordinary people worldwide will be left holding the bag. Our intelligence network tells us that this is most probable. Not very good news, is it? Well, folks, the subject of this program tonight is how did we get to this point in history where the greatest nation in the history of the world is on the brink of total and final economic collapse? You're going to be amazed at what you're going to learn this hour. Many of you are going to be shocked, surprised, and some of you are going to be, in fact, I think the great majority of you, are going to be ashamed of yourselves. Why is it that our schools teach our children nothing about money, economics? Why is it that we know, as a people, literally nothing about the monetary system and the economic system that our country operates under? How is it that most Americans believe that a private corporation known as the Federal Reserve Bank is an agency of the United States government when it is not? How is it that we write checks to the Internal Revenue Service believing that we are paying taxes and we are not? Why is it that in the nation with the most opportunity, the greatest affluence that the world has ever known, what used to be, is not now, but what used to be the best educational system on the face of this earth, with a constitution that guarantees each individual equality and freedom? What has happened, dear listeners? Well, in the next 50 or so minutes, you're going to find out. And when you find out, I want each and every one of you to hang your heads in shame. For we have not been invaded by the evil empire or some foreign army. No one has breached our shores. We have been destroyed from within, mostly by our own apathy, ignorance, and abdication of responsibility. And just as the Roman Empire once fell for the same reasons, we are in the process of falling into the abyss. And Americans, I can tell you right now, if they do not wake up and turn the tide, they will be relegated to slavery as indentured servants to the world bankers who will foreclose on the debt. A debt that at this moment we could not repay by any means whatsoever. Let's go to the United States Constitution, the supreme law of this land. in it, we can get at the very root of the problem that confronts us today, for in examining this document, we find that we are not conforming to the law. In Article 1, Section 8, it says, "The Congress shall have power to lay and collect taxes, duties, imposts, and excises, to pay the debts and provide for the common defense and general welfare of the United States. But all duties, imposts, and excises shall be uniform throughout the United States. The Congress shall have power to lay and collect taxes, duties, imposts, and excises, to pay the debts and provide for the common defense and general welfare of the United States. But all duties, imposts, and excises shall be uniform throughout the United States." Paragraph 2. "To borrow money on the credit of the United States." Paragraph 3, "To regulate commerce with foreign nations and among the several states and with the Indian tribes." Paragraph 5, "To coin money." Notice it says to coin money. "Regulate the value thereof and of foreign coin and fix the standard of weights and measures." Now the next time that we find any mention of money or coinage whatsoever is in Article 1, Section 9. "The migration," this is in paragraph 1, "the migration or importation of such persons as any of the states now existing shall think proper to admit shall not be prohibited by the Congress prior to the year 1808, but a tax or duty may be imposed on such importation not exceeding $10 for each person." And then it goes all the way down to paragraph 4, "No capitation or other direct tax shall be laid unless in proportion to the census or enumeration herein before directed to be taken." In paragraph 5, "No tax or duty shall be laid on articles exported from any state." So, then we go to paragraph 6. "No preference shall be given by any regulation or commerce or revenue to the ports of one state over those of another, nor shall vessels bound to or from one state be obliged to enter, clear, or pay duties in another." Paragraph 7. "No money shall be drawn from the treasury, but in consequence of appropriations made by law, and a regular statement and account of the receipts and expenditures of all public money shall be published from time to time." The next mention we have of money in any form, taxes, duties, coinage, money, whatever you want to call it, is in Section 10. And in Section 10, it makes an incredible statement. Article 1, Section 10 of the Constitution of the United States of America, in paragraph 1, says, "No state shall enter into any treaty, alliance, or confederation, grant letters of marque and reprisal, coin money, emit bills of credit," and catch this, folks, I'm reading directly from the Constitution, quote, "make anything but gold and silver coin a tender in payment of debts," unquote. And to continue, "pass any bill of attainder ex post facto law or law impairing the obligation of contracts or grant any title of nobility." So remember, in Article 1, Section 8, paragraph 5, it says the Congress shall have the power to coin money, regulate the value thereof, and of foreign coin, and fix the standard of weights and measures. And folks, in Article 1, Section 10, it says that no state shall make anything but gold and silver coin a tender in payment of debts. Now, I would like every single one of you to take a dollar bill out of your pocket right at this moment, and I want each and every one of you to take a quarter or a nickel or a dime, I don't care what it is, take it out of your pocket. In fact, take them all out of your pocket. Take one of each denomination of coin out of your pocket and lay it on the table before you, or on the arm of your chair, or just hold them in your hand. Now, if you have indeed done that, you are looking at several coins and you're looking at a dollar bill, but that's okay. It could be a $10 bill, a $5, a $20. It doesn't matter what it is. What you're looking at is evidence evidence of the greatest heist in the history of the world. The robbery of an entire nation, of all of its assets, natural resources, and people. And I will explain that to you. If you take each one of those coins, you will find that none of them are silver or gold. None of them, not one. You may have a quarter that looks like it is silver, or a dime that looks like it is silver, but it is what is called copper clad. In other words, it's a copper coin, a bus token, if you will. It's exactly what it is, a bus token, a piece of copper, to which they have applied a very, very thin coating of silver alloy. It's not even pure silver. It's not pure silver so that it doesn't wear off too quickly. Silver alloy to make it look like it is silver, to fool you. Because most people, if they have a coin that looks like silver, to them, it is. To me, it's nothing but a bus token, folks, and that's what it should be to you, too. Look at the dollar bill. On that dollar bill, down at the bottom, it says $1, and that is a lie. It cannot be $1 if it does not conform to the Constitution's version of what a dollar is. And the Constitution says, to coin money and regulate the value thereof. It's in Article 1, Section 8, Paragraph 5. And in Article 1, Section 10, Paragraph 1, no state shall make anything but gold and silver coin a tender in payment of debts. So it cannot be a dollar, and I'll tell you why it cannot be a dollar. It cannot be a dollar because it is fiat money. Fiat money is counterfeit money. It means it cannot be exchanged for gold or silver coin. In fact, it cannot be exchanged for anything. And it is worth only what some fool is willing to give you for it. The other lie on that piece of paper called a Federal Reserve note is just that, the term Federal Reserve note. A note, as defined by the dictionary, is something that records that someone else owes something to somebody. And a note can be called and exchanged for whatever collateral is presented against the note. For instance, if you borrow money on your house and you cannot pay the money back, they can come with the note and take the house. I think you all understand that. The house is worth something. But if they came with a note and you just gave them another note, boy, you'd be laughing, wouldn't you? You got a house, they got nothing but two notes. And if they come with those two notes and give them to you and you give them two other notes, what have they got? That's exactly what is happening with this phony fiat counterfeit treasonous paper called a Federal Reserve note. And this is what is destroying our country, folks. It is not money, it is worthless. In fact, that bill that you're holding in your hand is worth less than a blank sheet of paper because it's all covered with ink and you can't even use it to write on. You see, the only thing that gives that Federal Reserve note any value whatsoever is the number of fools who are willing to accept it. For one time in this country, we had gold certificates and silver certificates. And you could take any one of those pieces of paper, if it was a gold certificate and it was a $500 gold certificate, you could exchange it for $500 in gold coin at any bank. Any bank. If it was a silver certificate and it was a $1 note, you could take it and exchange it for $1 in silver coin at any bank. Our money was the most valuable, most coveted, most sought after money in the world because it had value, substance, worth. All wealth stems from the land, folks. everything else that is not of the land will ultimately decay and disappear into thin air, or into dust, or into air and dust, or in a puff of smoke if it burns. Money must be backed by the wealth that comes from the land. If it is not, it is worthless. Worthless. Has no value whatsoever. Now, I cannot understand how the American people allowed our money to be debased, to be taken away from us, to be counterfeited. And that's what a Federal Reserve note is. It's a counterfeit dollar because it does not conform to the definition of what our money is in the Constitution, and thus is illegal. How did they get away with this? The Federal Reserve Bank was established in 1914. After a meeting in 1913 on an island called Jekyll Island by some of the wealthiest bankers in this nation, representing, I might add, European banking interests. And they conned the Congress of the United States into forming a central bank. Not a central bank owned and operated by the United States government, folks, but a privately owned corporation called the Federal Reserve as the central bank of the United States of America. The Federal Reserve Act exempted this private corporation from paying income taxes and made it against the law to audit them. They have never, ever been audited, and I'm going to tell you why. Because, folks, if they were to be audited, you would find out that this country has literally been stolen from us. Because here's how the Federal Reserve Bank operates. They have two ways of stealing money from the American people. Actually, three. Three ways. The first is that if the United States needs money, let's say, they print up 1,000 $1 bills. The Federal Reserve then agrees to loan the United States $1,000. They buy those 1,000 $1 bills from the United States Treasury, where it was printed, for just a little over $20. That's the printing costs, and there's no profit built into that. And then they turn around and loan those dollars to the United States of America. You see, the money never existed. They don't open a bank vault and take out $1,000 and loan it to the United States of America. No, sir. They make a bookkeeping entry. They create this money out of thin air. It never existed before in the history of the world. They then pay the United States Treasury a little over $20 for each $1,000 in $1 bills that is printed, or they just issue the money to the United States as a loan in the form of credit without printing any money. They then loan this money to the United States of America in the form of Federal Reserve notes. And then, to guarantee that the United States will pay them back, the United States gives them a $1,000 Treasury bond, which pays interest to the Federal Reserve bankers. Now, I don't know about you, but I call this theft. You see, what they have done, folks, is just pocketed approximately $980 that they never had before. Plus, they're going to pocket the interest that they're going to earn on that $1,000 Treasury bond above and beyond the $1,000 that we have to pay them back. So they have literally stolen from the people of the United States of America approximately $980 plus the interest from the Treasury bond. The United States Treasury, in return, has received just a little over $20 for the printing of those $1,001 bills, and that includes no profit.
This is highway robbery. This is despicable. This is what has happened to this country. I'm going to explain a few things to you now, folks, that you probably never knew. That's the first way that they steal money from the people of the United States of America. The second way that they steal it is through the repayment of the loan with the interest that was never created. You see, if the interest was never created, it has to come from somewhere. Where does it come from? From the sweat and the tears and the labor and the resources of the American people. It comes out of your substance. It's the same as if I had a dollar and I loan 10 cents to 10 people, each at 10% simple interest over 1 year's period, which means they must pay me back each 11 cents. But you see, in this little world that I've created here, there's only $1. That's all that exists. And I have loaned that dollar out to these 10 people who had no money before. Now, each one has 10 cents. Yet each one of them have to pay me back 11 cents. Now, that equals $1.10, folks. How are they going to pay me back 11 cents each if all that exists in this whole world is $1? One of them has to go down the tubes in order to furnish the interest for the others to pay. That's how it works, folks. One of them has to go down the tubes in order for the others to pay back their money with interest. Either that, or I create out of thin air some more money so that the one who isn't doing so well can borrow more money from me. That puts more money out there. And the byproduct of that transaction is inflation, and everybody gets just a little bit poorer so that they can pay it back. But it requires that somebody always owe somebody else money, and it requires that the debt always escalate in order that the theft of the money not be found out, that the people don't find out that I'm creating this money that I'm loaning them out of thin air. Now, also there has to be a measure to remove some of this money from circulation constantly, because the constant creation of money that never existed before and putting it into circulation will create rampant, unbelievable inflation. If there is not some way, some measure to ensure that some of that money is taken out of circulation. And to do this, I create an organization which is a collection agency to collect the debt that the people owe me. And in real life, this is called the Internal Revenue Service, which is also a private corporation incorporated in the state of Delaware. Didn't know that, did you, folks? Go get your checks that you used to pay your taxes with. The check that you wrote. If you didn't owe any taxes, you didn't write a check, so you can't do this. But if you owed some taxes and you wrote a check and you paid your taxes with this check, go get that check out of your records, look on the back of it, and you'll see that the check that you thought that went to the United States Treasury did not. On the back, there's a rubber stamp that says pay any FRB. That means Federal Reserve Bank. And then it says, in payment of OBLIG, in payment of U.S. OBLIG. That means in payment of the United States obligation. Obligation to who? To the Federal Reserve. You see, what's happening is the Internal Revenue Service is not depositing your taxes that you pay, that you think you're paying, into the United States Treasury. It is going directly to the Federal Reserve Bank and then out of this country to prevent the American people from realizing that money is being created out of thin air and that our wealth, our natural resources, our nation, our substance, our people, our property is being stolen from us because, folks, you're going to hear it here for the first time if you've never heard it before in your life. The national debt can never be repaid. Never. And all of this is why I laughed so hard when George Bush made the suggestion that we put a box on our income tax forms that we could check if we wanted a portion of our taxes to go to pay off the national debt. What a joke. And so many people swallowed it hook, line, and sinker. You see, all your taxes go to the Federal Reserve Bank, and the national debt can never be repaid. Never. Never. And because of that, at some future date, and I believe that that date is very soon, is just around the corner, just barely over the horizon, the world bankers are going to demand payment of the money that we owe them, and we don't have any money to pay them. The United States will be forced to declare bankruptcy, and the bankers will foreclose on the debt. You see, there's no way we can ever pay it back, because none of the interest was ever, ever created. And the only real amount of money that the Federal Reserve ever loaned to the United States was $100 at the inception of the Federal Reserve. The interest on that debt alone is over $27,000 over the years. The rest of the money that we have borrowed from the Federal Reserve never, ever existed. And that's why it was written in the law and insisted upon that the Federal Reserve would not have to pay income tax and would never be subject to audit. Congress gave away the nation. They were traitors. The Congress that passed the Federal Reserve Act were traitors, for they ensured the destruction of this nation and the enslavement of its people. By passing that act. For they knew that this money would be created out of thin air, and they also knew that if the United States established its own bank, we could create United States notes backed by the good faith and credit of the United States of America, which would not be interest-bearing. But they didn't do that. No, they created a central bank owned by private people, a private corporation, that has been stealing this country ever since. You see, shortly after that happened, in about 1938, the United States declared bankruptcy once already. When they declared that bankruptcy, in order to become solvent again, they pledged against the loan the entire resources of the United States of America, which includes all property, all natural resources, and the only thing in the world that has the ability to create wealth, its people. So the next bankruptcy will accomplish the following, folks. All property in the United States will be seized as collateral for the debt of the United States, including all natural resources, all real property, real estate, all consumable goods, which are stereos, TVs, food, anything, everything. The corporations know this, and that's why they're all leaving the country. and the people of the United States, the citizens, will become indentured to the international bankers for however long it takes to repay the loan. Well, put that in your pipe and smoke it. We're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back after this pause. But these people will fall into a trap, you see, because in order to continue living, they must continue borrowing. And to continue borrowing ensures the fact that they will never pay back the debt, and they will be slaves in the New World Order forever. Those of you who have called my hotline in Los Angeles and wondered why I kept tagging on to the end, and this is exactly what my hotline says, folks. And by the way, that number is area code 310-281-8222. 310-281-8222. At the end of the messages that I leave there, I always make this statement. Quote, "For those of you who are helping me in this fight, God bless you. For the rest of you, you're going to get exactly what you deserve. You're going to be slaves in the New World Order." Unquote. This was not an arbitrary statement by me. It is a statement of fact. When the United States government is forced to declare bankruptcy, and it will be forced to declare bankruptcy, and all of you are thinking about our children are going to pay back the national debt, or their children, or their great-great-grandchildren, it can never happen, folks. It can never happen. Because it's not just the government. You see, every time the government borrows, it has to pay back interest. And every time each one of you borrow, you have to pay back interest that was never, ever in the history of the world created. It doesn't exist. And are you ready for this? There's a third way that they've been stealing from us. You see, it's called fractional reserve lending. The Federal Reserve Bank allows fractional reserve lending. What this means is they can lend out as much as 10 to 1 or more based upon funds held in reserve. So a Federal Reserve Bank could, if they wanted to, and they do want to, and they do it frequently and have done it often, and it has resulted in a terrible thing. Say a Federal Reserve Bank has $1,000 on account in reserve. Now remember, this is not even real money. It's the fiat Federal Reserve notes to begin with. It's counterfeit. This bank can now loan out $10,000 as a bookkeeping entry, which it doesn't even have, and it's issued in the form of credit. Credit against the Federal Reserve Bank. Now, let's say they want to raise their assets in reserve so that they can loan out more money. They merely require the person that they loan this money to keep that money on deposit in their bank. So if they loan him $10,000, only $1,000 really exists now, and that's the fiat Federal Reserve notes, the counterfeit money. They require him to redeposit or deposit this $10,000 in their bank. So he does this. They now have, as a bookkeeping entry, $11,000 as assets deposited in that bank. They can now loan out $110,000 against that $11,000 in assets. And again, if they want to be able to have more on reserve to loan out, all they have to do is require that whoever laid the loan the $110,000 to redeposit it in the same bank. And now folks, they can loan out $1,100,000 based upon an original reserve of $1,000. And this has been compounded so much over the entire Federal Reserve System that I'm going to tell you right now, there is no money in the banks. Our banks are insolvent. Over the last year, over 500 banks have folded. Just in the last year. The entire savings and loan system has crumbled. Now, you think your deposits are safe because of the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, FDIC? And you think your deposits are safe because of the FDSLI? Well, they're not, folks. And those are not agencies of the United States government either. You've all been fooled. You think because it says federal that it's an arm of the government and it's backed by the government and you can't lose your money? You're wrong. You know, you can, but you will lose your money. You're going to. It doesn't matter what you do. And if all that you can think of is saving your assets, I can guarantee you, you're going to lose your ass. And I don't mean the four-legged one out in the barnyard, folks. The only way to save your assets is to save the Constitution, is to force the traitors who are sitting in Congress to audit the Federal Reserve. And the only answer to this entire problem, I can guarantee you, is to nationalize the Federal Reserve, declare all of those who have had a hand in the ownership or the creation of the Federal Reserve to be criminals, arrest them, seize all of their assets, and issue United States notes, non-interest notes, while we build up our reserves of gold and silver so that we can once again mint constitutional money. If we are not willing to do this, if we will not do it, then we are doomed. And there is no way out other than what I have just told you. And I'm the only one in this country who's got the guts to tell it to you, because anyone else who's ever tried has been murdered. Murdered by these creeps. And they all belong to secret societies. It is not a Jewish plot. It is not a Catholic plot. It is not a plot by the blacks or the Poles or the Protestants or anyone else. These men belong to secret societies, and this problem is as old as man. You see, the first international bankers ever in this world were known as the Knights Templar. The Knights Templar were rounded up in France only and arrested by King Philip. On November the 22nd in the year 1307, Pope Clement V issued a papal bull condemning the Knights Templars to torture. That's the same date of the assassination of President John F. Kennedy in Dallas, which is on the 33rd parallel, by the way. Dealey Plaza is on the 33rd parallel. In Dealey Plaza, there's a plaque commemorating the location of the first Masonic temple in the state of Texas. And he was shot once in the back at the approximate location of the heart, in the throat, and in the head, the exact same wound suffered by Hiram Abiff in the Masonic initiations. If you visit Dealey Plaza, you will see the four quarters of a Celtic temple and an obelisk with a flame on the top. These are all the symbols of an outdoor temple of the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry, the worship of an ancient religion, Baal, the light, the sun, Lucifer, Osiris, Satan, all the same. Kennedy was in the process of printing United States notes. Freemasonry was infiltrated and taken over by the Knights Templars as they fled the persecution of the Pope and the kings of Europe. The international bankers today are the Knights Templars, folks. And the arm through which they operate is Freemasonry, the Rosicrucians, the Ancient Order of the Rosen Cross, and many other organizations which appear to be outwardly fraternal organizations existing for the good of the community, but I can assure you they are not. This country is being destroyed from within. From within, by those who belong to these secret societies. And if you doubt this, folks, if you doubt this, if you don't understand what I'm telling you, and if you're not willing to go look to find out if it's true, if you're not willing to study, the destruction of this country and the enslavement of its people are a certainty, and it is now imminent. Imminent. Stop fighting each other. Stop fighting each other. You must understand who the enemy is. You must understand what we have to do to stop what's coming. You must begin to learn about real economics and real money, and you have to understand that no matter what they do to the price of oil, it will never result in inflation. Inflation is not caused by raising or lowering the price of anything, folks. Inflation is caused by flooding the economy with money. Worthless paper, making more money available in the form of loans, in the form of credit, in the form of cash, by running the printing presses, and that is what causes inflation. And it was an intentional inflation, according to their plan, to put both parents to work so that the children would be relegated to government-controlled daycare centers where they are taught how to live in the New World Order. You better wake up, folks. We are in real trouble now. The only answer is to audit the Federal Reserve, nationalize the Federal Reserve, prosecute all who were connected with its formation and with its ownership as criminals, traitors. If any people or any nation objects or resists, we must back this up with the full force of our military might. And believe me, if we can do this, every nation in this world will thank us for taking us out from under the yoke of these secret societies. And only then will our economy improve. Only then will we be able to eliminate the debt by decree, because it is based upon fraud, upon theft, and begin again. If we do not do this, I'm going to say this once again, we are doomed. There is no way out of this other than what I have just told you. There is no way that anyone in this country can ever pay back the national debt, because the interest was never created. And the debt itself was created out of thin air, never existed, is fraud. Fraud. You see, we could have printed that kind of money ourselves and never owed ourselves anything, and would never have had to pay any interest on what we owed ourselves. Now let me acquaint you with another fact. There is very little, if any, gold in Fort Knox. It was all sold at a discount during the Nixon administration, and only insiders were ever told that the sale would take place. It was sold at a discount from $32 an ounce on the world gold market, when at the time the price of gold was well over $100 an ounce. The American people were never told, never had a chance to buy any of that gold, and the people who bought it at a discount from $32 an ounce made a handsome profit at the expense of the people of this country. What are they guarding at Fort Knox? They're guarding the secret that there's no gold. That's what they're guarding. Folks, I have taken great risk in bringing you this information tonight, because no other media personality, talk show host, or broadcast station has the guts to tell you what I just told you. And if it actually goes out over the air and stays out over the air, I'll consider myself very lucky. And if I stay alive after you hear this broadcast, I will be even luckier. But the chances are that no action will be taken against me simply because it will prove that everything that I've said in this broadcast is absolutely 100% correct. I want you to make tapes of this broadcast and send them to everyone that you know. If you don't have a tape recorder, you may order tapes of this broadcast, studio quality tapes. Tapes are $7.50 for CAGI members, $17.50 for non-CAGI members. That's $7.50 for CAGI members, $17.50 for non-CAGI members. That includes postage and handling. You can order them by writing to me, William Cooper, Post Office Box 3299, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322. That's Post Office Box 3299, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322. And while you're at it, folks, you better take advantage of our membership offer for CAGI. That's the Citizens Agency for Joint Intelligence. That is the intelligence network that brings you the material that is included in each one of these programs. The Citizens Agency for Joint Intelligence is a group of citizens who wish to save the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, this nation, and thus freedom for the world. For if this country falls, all freedom worldwide will fall with it, and man will cease to exist as a sovereign, free, individual, king in his own right, with a government as his chattel servant, and will once again be relegated to the position of someone else's property. The membership fee, folks, is $45. That's $45 membership fee for CAGI, the Citizens Agency for Joint Intelligence. With membership, you get a certificate and identification card, which you can use for discounts at my workshops or lectures as I travel around this country. You will also get a newsletter. You'll have access to our computer bulletin board system and all of the research files that are included in that database. We're going to have many other benefits for our members, and we will be lobbying Congress constantly, representing our members, to make sure that freedom reigns in this world and not despotism, which is coming. If you'd like to join the Citizens Agency for Joint Intelligence, CAGI, send $45 to William Cooper, Post Office Box 3299, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322. That's Post Office Box 3299, Camp Verde, spelled V as in Victor, E-R-D-E, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322. Or you can just call Stan on the phone and ask him to send you a packet of information. His number is 602-567-6109. That's Stan at 602-567-6109. Please call him during normal daylight hours. Also, I recommend that you order my book, Behold a Pale Horse. It's 500 pages of the most suppressed, most documented suppressed information ever printed in the history of the world, and I've been told this by experts. Without this book, you're going to be crippled in the coming months and years. This will tell you everything, why it's happening, who is doing it, what the plan is, when all of this is going to take place. And it is fully documented. And you need it. You need this book. It's taken me most of my life to gather this information and put it into a book. And I'm working on my second book now, which I can't give you a publication date yet. But if you'd like to purchase Behold a Pale Horse, if you're a CAGI member, send $25. That includes postage and handling. If you're not a CAGI member, send $30. That includes postage and handling. to William Cooper, Post Office Box 3299, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322. That's Post Office Box 3299, Camp Verde, Arizona, 86322. By the way, folks, my book is the only book in the world that I know of that's fully guaranteed. If you get that book and you decide that's not what you wanted for your money, send it right back to us in the same condition you received it in, brand new, and we'll refund your money, no questions asked. Now, if you send us a used book, or if it's been read, or the cover's been crinkled back, or pages turned down, we will not. You will get the book right back. But remember, it's guaranteed. If you take a look at it when you get it, it's not what you want. You send it directly back to us in brand new condition, and we will refund your money cheerfully. Let me read to you again the little news article that we read at the beginning of this show. Former banker and financial analyst Michael William Haga, author of the forthcoming book, On the Brink, How to Survive the Coming Great Depression, 1993 to 2000, says this. Within the next 12 months, the international banking system will collapse. The world's stock exchanges will crash to pre-World War II levels. Real estate values will plunge 85% or more, and countless numbers of ordinary people worldwide will be left holding the bag. The United States will be left in the position of forced bankruptcy. The real property, the resources, the natural resources, and the people who create the resources in the United States of America will simply be foreclosed upon. And we will become indentured to the world banking system, to the New World Order. We will be slaves, folks. This is coming. Anyone with any sense, with any understanding of economics, with finances, with the kind of situation that we are really in, and not what George Herbert Walker Bush or his ilk tell you, if you understand all of these things, you know this is coming. You know it.
And don't let yourself be fooled by this insane assertion that we're in the midst of a recovery, because that is a lie.
And there's only one way to save ourselves, and that's the way that I have outlined during this program tonight. There is no other way.
Now, folks, I want you all to realize that we're not trying to scare you by bringing you this information. We have looked at this in every way possible, and this is the only answer that we can find. We've been living in fantasy land. Now, if you can come up with better answers or a better solution, please write to me and let me know. And if it checks out, we'll put it on the air. But this is the way we see it right now. And this is the way our intelligence organization, TAGI, also sees it. It doesn't look good. But we can save ourselves and we can save this country if we wake up now and do something about it. We must nationalize the Federal Reserve. We must prosecute all those connected with the Federal Reserve and the Internal Revenue Service as criminals. We must confiscate all of their property and all of their wealth and give it to the Treasury of the United States. We must print United States notes while we build up our reserves of gold and silver so once again we can mint constitutional money. Now, this is one time, folks, that I can tell you sincerely that I hope that I am wrong. I hope that our intelligence network that has given this information is wrong. But it doesn't look that way. And we can't hide from this either, folks. As George Bush would say, read my lips, New World Order. Good night, and God bless each and every one of you.
He lays his unwashed hair. soul. When you walk the night for soul. Happened to his family. You know he died in the cold.